Good afternoon, friends. I am Pankaj Sharma, lecturer of physics at Government Polytechnic, Ahmedabad. In previous lectures, we have discussed the magnetic materials that can produce magnetic field around them, known as magnets. And also, we have discussed in detail that any current carrying conductor or any current element can produce a magnetic field around it, in which any other magnet placed experiences some magnetic force. After discussing these things, we discussed in detail that a current carrying loop also corresponds to a magnet. It has two sides of it. One acts as north pole of the magnet, like magnet, and other side of the loop acts as south pole of a magnet. So in a sense, the current loop behaves as if it is a magnet. So if a large number of current loops are put together symmetrically, concentrically, then this arrangement is known as solenoid. And we have also discussed the field produced inside a solenoid. Now we are going to utilize the concept of magnetic field produced by the current loop. Now, on the basis of this magnetic field produced by the current loop, we will be discussing in detail different types of magnetic materials, which are broadly categorized into three categories: diamagnetic materials, paramagnetic materials, and ferromagnetic materials. So dear friends, let's start with magnetic properties of matter. As we all know, the matter is made up of atoms, and atoms are made up of nuclei and electrons. Means any kind of atom is made up of nucleus and electrons. Nucleus is at the center of the atom, and the electrons are revolving around the nucleus in certain orbits that are known as Bohr orbits. Because these electrons are moving in definite orbits, so they constitute electric current loops. Or electrons moving in short orbits, orbits of smaller radii, corresponds to tiny current loops. And because of these current loops, they has got a magnetic dipole moment associated with them, and that is because of their orbital motion. So because of orbital motion of the electrons, means if we consider an electron which has got positive nucleus at the center of it, and the electrons revolving around it in certain orbits, so each electron is moving in certain orbit. There are various, depending upon the configuration of the atom, there are number of atoms in each orbit. So because these are moving in circular orbits, they constitute current, so they correspond to current loops. And as we have discussed earlier, that any current loop is equivalent to a magnet. So motion of a single electron in an atom can be thought of a tiny magnet. So in that way, atom is considered to having a lot of tiny magnets associated with it due to the orbital motion of the electrons. And the current loop has magnetic dipole moment, and magnetic dipole moment of the electron is given by the formula, as we have already discussed. This magnetic moment of the electron is nothing but the current associated with the electron into the area of the loop. Area of the loop. For a circular orbit of radius r, this would be pi r square, area of the circle, and this is mu l, l for orbital motion. So the magnetic moments of the electron of an atom have a tendency to cancel in pair. This is the most important properties of the electrons. In case of more than one electrons, the magnetic moments, orbital magnetic moments, have tendency to cancel out each effect of each other when the electrons are considered in pair. So the origin of magnetic dipole moment. The magnetic moment in a material originates from the orbital motion and spinning motion of the electrons in an atom. Actually, electrons are moving around the nucleus, but along with that, even if electron is at rest, it has got an intrinsic angular momentum associated with it. So with that inherent property, it has associated with it net spin magnetic dipole moment, that is known as spin magnetic dipole moment. Here is the case of an electron that is moving around the nucleus in certain orbit. We are considering here a single electron, and its magnetic dipole moment mu l, l for orbital motion and m for magnetic. So orbital magnetic moment is given by, if we are going to consider this case, here is the nucleus and around it this electron is moving in certain orbit. This electron, and let the direction be this. So the magnetic moment associated with the electron, mu electron, will be equals to the current it constitute into the area of the loop, where I is the current and area of the loop in which electron revolves. If we imagine that electron moves in a circular path of radius r, let this be radius r, about the nucleus with a velocity, let's say v, it makes v over 2 pi r. 2 pi r is the total circumference of the orbit, and v is the velocity. This is equals to omega upon 2 pi revolutions per second. Then I current can be written as equals to E dot omega over 2 pi, and A equals to area of the loop is given as pi r square. The magnetic moment has the magnitude mu for electron equals to E omega square, omega r square, upon 2. This can be expressed in terms of angular momentum of the electron as mu electron equals to minus E by twice m, m r omega square, or equals to minus E by twice m into the angular momentum. Minus sign here indicates that the magnetic dipole moment of the electron due to its orbital motion and the angular momentum of the orbital motion are in opposite direction. Or here we can calculate the same magnetic moment this is the area of the loop, pi r square, r is the radius of the orbit, and this is I. I is nothing but the charge per unit time. Or this can be simplified as pi r square q into f, because 1 upon t is nothing but the frequency, revolutions per unit time. By multiplying it and dividing it, this term, second term, by 2 pi, we have pi r square q by 2 pi into 2 pi f. Now 2 pi f is known as angular velocity or angular frequency of the electron that is moving in the orbit. So we are left with pi r square q over 2 pi into v over r, as v equals to r omega. So mu, magnetic dipole moment due to orbital motion of the electron, comes out to be q v r upon 2. Or this can be simply written as, if we multiply it by and divide it by this term by m, mass of the electron, so then mass is multiplied by v r, so mvr term is nothing but the angular momentum of the electron, and this is orbital magnetic dipole moment equals to q over 2m into l. Here we have written it as mu electrical or mu lm, as shown in slide, equals to minus e by twice m into l, where this e is the charge on the electron. Charge on the electron is minus e. So this negative sign indicates that mu l is opposite to that of angular momentum of the electron. Now we are coming to the magnetization. As we have seen, that electrons moving in an orbit around the nucleus corresponds to tiny magnets, and these magnets have with them an associated magnetic dipole moment. Whenever there is no external magnetic field applied to the material, these all magnets, or say magnets due to these current loops, are randomly oriented. So there is no net dipole moment in any direction. So we say that the material is not magnetized yet. But as soon as we put the material in an external magnetic field, then the dipole moment experiences a torque, and due to which they try to align themselves either in the direction of the magnetic field or in the direction opposite to that of magnetic field, depending upon their nature. So in a sense, they try to align themselves in the direction of magnetic field so that there is magnetization, because the net dipole moment this time is positive in a given volume. So we are going to define here a term, magnetization, that is nothing but the magnetic dipole moments present in a given volume of the material. Here we can see the picture. In this picture here, on the left hand side, these arrows, little arrows, are representing the magnetic dipole moment associated with an atom of the material. As there are large number of atoms present in the material, there are large number of magnetic dipole moments oriented randomly. And when we apply a magnetic field or external magnetic field is applied to the material, these tiny dipole moments try to align themselves in some particular direction. So the intensity of magnetization, or simply magnetization, measures the magnetization of the magnetized specimen. Intensity of magnetization, that is represented by a vector m. is defined as the magnetic dipole moment per unit volume. and its unit is ampere per meter. Magnetization or intensity of magnetization is defined as the magnetic dipole moment per unit volume of the material. Now we are coming to the next term, that is magnetic susceptibility. Magnetic susceptibility is nothing but the measure of the ease with which a specimen can be magnetized by the magnetizing force. Here the magnetizing force is some external magnetic field. We see that some materials, when put in an external magnetic field, are easily magnetized, whereas there are some materials, when put in an external magnetic field, are not so easily magnetized. So the measure of ease with which the materials are magnetized is known as, or is represented by, a term that is known as magnetic susceptibility. Magnetic susceptibility is defined as the ratio of magnetization produced in a sample of the material to the magnetic field intensity, or say the magnetization per unit field intensity. So here is the term susceptibility is represented by xi equals to whatever magnetization we have divided by the magnetic field intensity H. As magnetization is nothing but, from the above equation, magnetic dipole moment per unit volume has the same unit as that of magnetic field intensity. So it has got no unit, or it is a dimensionless quantity. In this equation we have written here no unit. Magnetization and magnetic field intensity both are the vector quantity. They have got direction with them, in the direction of applied magnetic field. Next term, there is the permeability of a given matter. Permeability is defined as, on applying magnetic field, when material gets magnetized, magnetic field inside the material is the sum of applied magnetic field and the magnetic field due to the magnetization. When if we consider a solenoid, suppose there is a solenoid in which the current I is flowing through it, and if there is no material placed inside the solenoid, then the inside magnetic field is equals to simply B equals to mu naught H. But as soon as we put a magnetic material inside the solenoid, then the dipole moments of that material try to align themselves in the direction of applied field. So the intensity of magnetization inside the magnetic field is greater than the applied magnetic field. So this time, inside the material, the sum of the applied magnetic field and the magnetic field due to the magnetization is equal to the magnetic field inside the material. Or this equation can be written as B equals to mu 0 H M. This next term is permeability. When we talk about permeability, so there is another term, relative permeability. If there is no magnetic material inside the solenoid, then we use the magnetic permeability of the free space mu 0. But when we put a magnetic material inside the solenoid, then comes the magnetic permeability of that material mu. So mu 0 is the permeability of free space, mu is the permeability of the mu, and there is another term, relative permeability. That is the permeability of any material relative to the permeability of the free space. So relative permeability is the ratio of permeability of the medium to the permeability of the free space, or this can be written as permeability of the medium to the permeability of the free space. So again, because it's a ratio of two permeabilities, it has no unit. Mu r can be related to xi as mu r equals to 1 plus xi. Now, on the basis of the alignment of magnetic dipole moment in materials, the magnetic materials can be classified into three broad categories. Number one, diamagnetic materials. Number two, paramagnetic materials. And number three, ferromagnetic materials. We will discuss these three types of materials one by one. So let's start with the diamagnetic materials or the diamagnetism in the magnetic materials. So diamagnetic materials, in diamagnetic materials, individual atom of a material do not have a net magnetic dipole moment, as we have already discussed. In some atoms, what happens, there are even number of electrons present inside the atom, and we know that these dipole moments, magnetic dipole moments due to orbital motion, have a tendency to cancel out each other in pairs. So individual atom of a material do not have a net magnetic dipole moment. But when placed in a magnetic field, dipole moments are induced. Means initially the effect of magnetic dipole moments are cancelled out by each other when in pairs, but when these types of materials are placed in an external magnetic field, the dipole moments are induced, and magnetic field due to the induced magnetic moments opposes the applied field. What does it mean? That whenever we are going to apply external magnetic field to these types of materials, the magnetic moments are induced in such a way that they opposes the applied magnetic field. Or in other words, we say that these induced magnetic dipole moments try to align themselves in the direction opposite to that of applied magnetic field. Or in short, these types of materials are magnetized in the direction opposite to that of applied magnetic field. So resultant field is smaller than the applied field. Here is the picture of diamagnetic materials. In normal case, each atom has with it a zero net dipole moment. There is no net magnetic dipole moment. But when we apply magnetic field, let's suppose in this direction, in the direction of arrow, the magnetic moment are induced in the direction opposite to that of applied magnetic field, or say the material is magnetized in the direction opposite to that of applied magnetic field. And when we remove this external magnetic field, again this induced orbital magnetic moment is disappeared and the material is said to be demagnetized. Diamagnetic materials, before coming on to the diamagnetic material properties, let's have a treatment of diamagnetic material. So the most popular, or say the old theory of diamagnetism, is known as classical theory or Langevin's theory of diamagnetism. So we are going to treat this Langevin theory in detail. In a diamagnetic material, the orbital electrons in pair cancel out the effect of each other, means their magnetic dipole moment cancels out. So net dipole moment associated with the atom is zero. But when we apply magnetic field to the material, or say atom, the magnetic moment is induced. And as we have seen earlier, the electron is equivalent to a tiny current loop, and with that current loop there is a magnetic moment, and when we apply magnetic field, this magnetic moment try to align itself in the direction of magnetic field. So we are starting with the classical theory. Classical theory of diamagnetism. The precision of magnetic dipole moment mu E L in a direction of magnetic field is equivalent to the precession of angular momentum. This will precess about an applied external applied magnetic field, like as a top revolve. Here is some top. It spins around its axis, and also this may precess about this axis like this. So motion of top is equivalent to here. That is known as actually Larmor precession. This motion is known as Larmor precession. Electron is moving. This is the direction of magnetic moment, and here is the electron that is moving around the nucleus. So this magnetic dipole moment presses around the inner magnetic field. It presses and precession in the same direction as the precession of angular momentum L about precession of magnetic dipole moment for electron, or the angular momentum of the electron about the magnetic field B. The equation of motion of vector L precessing around the B can be given as the rate of change of angular momentum is equals to the torque, where torque, this is the torque tau on the motion of electron, and torque is given as if a tiny magnet is placed in an external magnetic field, so it tries to align itself along the direction of magnetic field. So torque on this magnet in an external magnetic field is given as the dipole moment cross magnetic field, and this definitely dipole moment we are considering for electron. So this torque is exerted on the dipole, or this rate of change of angular momentum is equals to mu EL into B. Or if we substitute the value of mu EL from the previous equation, here mu EL equals to minus E by twice M into the angular momentum. What we have rate of change of momentum equals to minus E upon twice M into L cross B. Both these two quantities are vector quantity. This represents the precession motion of L cross B. So the rate of change of angular momentum will be changing in the direction that is perpendicular to the both L and B, because rate of change of momentum is equals to L cross B. Whenever there is a vector which is equal to the cross product of any two vectors, then the final vector is perpendicular to the both the vectors. So the change in the angular momentum will be perpendicular, always perpendicular to the L cross L and B. So change is perpendicular to the angular momentum and also perpendicular to the direction of magnetic field. So this represents a frequency of precession that is given by angular frequency omega equals to minus Eb by twice m. This is the angular frequency, or it is also known as Larmor frequency. Larmor precession, let's consider an atom which has got z number of electrons in it. So these z electrons are equivalent to a current that can be given as, we are having, let's say, z electrons in an atom which are equivalent to a current equivalent to current that is given as I equals to, current is nothing but charge per unit time, so charge is equals to charge on the electron into the number of electrons present there, and charge on the electron is minus E, and this is the charge per unit time. So we can say that revolution per unit time, or we can have I equals to minus Z E into 1 upon 2 pi Eb by twice m. Revolution per unit time, where does this come from? It comes from the definition of angular frequency, which is nothing but 2 pi the revolutions per second, and this is equals to, from the above equation, minus Eb by twice m, or say f can be written as 1 by 2 pi into Eb by twice m. So revolutions per unit time is 1 upon 2 pi into Eb by twice m, so that way current is given as minus Ze into 1 upon twice pi Eb by twice m. The magnetic moment of a current loop is given by the product of the current and the area of the loop. So in the next step, we are going to calculate the magnetic moment associated with this current. The magnetic moment is given as the current into area of the loop. So current is minus Ze into Eb by 2 pi into 2m into pi a square average, where a square average is the average radius of the electron from the field axis. We have taken here a square average. This is the sign for average, and this is the average radius from the field axis. Radius of the electron from the field axis. If the field is in z direction, in this direction, then a average square can be written as x square average plus y square average. The negative sign in the above equation indicates here, negative sign in this equation above, this equation indicates that the induced magnetic moment is always in opposite sense to that of applied magnetic field B. The mean square distance of the electron from the nucleus, mean means average, square distance of the electron from the nucleus can be given as x square average plus y square average plus z square average. We are considering it in three dimension. And if the charge is symmetrically distributed around the nucleus, this charge is symmetrically, electrons are symmetrically distributed, let's consider distributed around the nucleus, then this x square average in any direction would be equals to y square average equals to z square average, such that now the average distance from the nucleus can be given as 3 by 2 average of a square, where a square average is the average radius of the electron from the field axis. So on the basis of this, we can write, we have to put the value of a average, and a average is given by 2 by 3 r, or a square average can be written as 2 by 3 r square average. So the magnetic moment, here we are going to put the value of a square average as 2 by 3 r square average. So this equation becomes or takes the form mu equals to minus z e square upon 4m into b into 2 by 3 r square average, or just simplifying it, minus z e square b over 6m into r square average. If we are considering, let there be n number of atoms per unit volume, n number of atoms per unit volume, then with these n atoms there are n number of dipole moments associated per unit volume. So the magnetization, which is nothing but magnetic dipole moment per unit volume, is equals to n into mu. So the magnetization can be written as mu into n. So this would be minus z n e square b, which can be obtained just multiplying this equation by n, by 6m into r square average. Or in terms of magnetic field intensity, minus mu naught n z e square h magnetic field intensity upon 6m into r square average. Or from this equation we are going to have the expression for susceptibility, that is nothing but magnetization per unit magnetic field intensity comes out to be minus mu 0 n z, where z is the atomic number of the atom, e square by 6m into r square average. So this is the expression for the susceptibility of any diamagnetic material. We see this diamagnetic susceptibility is the classical Langevin result, or this is also known as Langevin's theory, or simply classical theory of diamagnetism. From this expression we see that the susceptibility is quite independent of temperature, and susceptibility depends upon the atomic number of the atom. So, and also this average distance, average radius of the electron from the nucleus can be calculated with the help of wave function that is introduced in quantum physics. So on the basis of final result, we are having the properties of magnetic materials. First of all, they have no permanent magnetic moment, but when these are placed in an external magnetic field, they are aligned in the direction opposite to that of magnetic field, and as we have seen in the result, that susceptibility comes out to be the negative, or it has got negative value. So diamagnetic materials repel magnetic field lines of force. The value of diamagnetic susceptibility is independent of temperature and applied magnetic field, as we have seen in the last expressions, xi equals to m over h equals to minus mu 0 and z e square upon 6 m r square average. So here there is no term representing the temperature and the magnetic field. So magnetic susceptibility of diamagnetic material is negative because the magnetic dipole moments are aligned in the direction opposite to that of magnetic field. It is also independent of the temperature and the applied magnetic field. So these are some of the properties that diamagnetic materials represent. And the examples of diamagnetic materials are some organic materials, alkali earth elements, and bismuth. Here we are having a case of diamagnetic materials. In case of, as you will study in some chapter, the phenomenon of superconductivity, where the resistivity or say resistance of the material suddenly drops to zero at certain critical temperature, and all the temperature which are lesser than this critical temperature, the material is said to be in superconducting state. Along with that property of resistivity equals to zero, they have got a fantastic property of diamagnetism. Means when the superconductors are placed in an external magnetic field, they behave like a perfect diamagnet. Perfect diamagnet means when they are placed in an external magnetic field, the magnetic dipole moments associated with the atom in these types of materials align themselves in such a way that they try to cancel out the effect of applied magnetic field, so that the magnetic field inside the material is zero, B equals to zero. Here in this diagram, we can see that all the magnetic field lines are passing from the outside of the material. No field line can cross or pass through this material. So B inside the material is zero, and this whole thing can be explained on the basis of the magnetism in the materials. B is equals to mu 0 H, which is from the applied magnetic field, plus second term is the contribution of magnetization. So B equals to mu naught H plus M. As B inside the material is 0, this equation gives H plus M equals to 0, or H equals to minus M, or the ratio of M upon H, which is nothing but the magnetic susceptibility of the material, comes out to be minus 1. So in case of perfect diamagnet, this susceptibility is minus 1. So perfect diamagnetic material or superconducting material is representing this phenomenon here. So susceptibility is minus 1, and this, on the basis of this effect, a new application we can have from these superconducting materials, and is that application is known as magnetic levitation. Now we are coming on to the paramagnetic materials. In paramagnetic materials, each atom is associated with a permanent magnetic dipole moment, unlike their diamagnetic counterpart. Whereas in case of diamagnetic materials, there is no net magnetic dipole moment associated with the atom, but in case of paramagnetic materials, a net magnetic dipole moment is associated with the atom of the material, because at room temperature these magnetic dipole moments are randomly oriented, or say these magnetic dipole moments are just placing inside the material in all possible directions. So in any particular direction there is no net dipole moment. So when there is no magnetic field applied to these materials, the net magnetic dipole moment is still zero. But when an external magnetic field is applied, these dipole moments associated with the atom try to align themselves, this time in the direction of the applied magnetic field. Here is the picture that is depicting the paramagnetism in the material. On the left, very left hand side, these are shown as the magnetic moments, dipole moments associated with each atom. Here we can see that these dipole moments are randomly oriented. So in a given volume, the net dipole moment is zero. And the net dipole moment in a given volume is nothing but the magnetization. So here in this case, the magnetization is zero. This is the case when we have not applied external magnetic field yet. But as soon as we apply the magnetic field in some direction, let's say in the direction of this arrow, these dipole moments, which were previously randomly oriented, now try to align themselves in the direction of magnetic field. And if we remove the external magnetic field, again they lose the phenomenon of magnetization. Then the magnetization upon removing the magnetic field is now zero. Here we have a list of magnetic susceptibilities of some paramagnetic materials and diamagnetic materials, just to compare them at 300 degree Kelvin or say room temperature. Here is the list. On the left hand side, some paramagnetic materials are there, and on the right hand side, diamagnetic substances are there. So susceptibility here on the left hand side in case of paramagnetic material, however it is very small, but is positive. So susceptibility in case of paramagnetic materials or substances is small, but is much smaller than 1, but positive. While in case of diamagnetic substances, susceptibility is very very less, and that too negative. So negative sign says that the dipole moments align themselves in the direction of opposite to that of applied magnetic field. Now we are coming to the ferromagnetic materials. In ferromagnetic materials, ferromagnetism is a special case of paramagnetism. In paramagnetism, we have that orbital magnetic moment is associated with the atom. Along with that orbital magnetic moment, in case of ferromagnetism, the spin magnetic moments interact with each other, and that is also known as exchange energy, or the moments are coupled with each other. So they produce strong magnetic dipole moments in a certain region of the magnetic material, and these regions are known as domains. In a domain, a large number of dipole moments, magnetic dipole moments, are aligned in some particular direction. So domains are with their directions, but these small regions in a volume of the material are randomly oriented. So their overall effect is net, that contributes to net dipole moment is zero itself. Next is, when the external magnetic field is applied, then these domains grows in the direction to the applied magnetic field, or say the ferromagnetic materials are strongly or permanently magnetized when applied magnetic field. So a strong positive magnetic susceptibility is there. Here we, in this picture, we are having the regions of the materials where a large number of magnetic moments are there and all are aligned in some direction for a given particular region. These regions are nothing but the domains. When we apply some field, initially they are randomly oriented, all the regions, so net dipole moment is still zero, but when we apply magnetic field, these regions try to align themselves in the direction of magnetic field. That way these regions grows, or the strong magnetic field is produced inside the material, or say magnetization is quite high. And at a certain temperature, because the susceptibility of ferromagnetic materials is temperature dependent, and at a certain temperature that is known as Curie temperature, these ferromagnetic materials loses their magnetization and they become paramagnetic materials. So at Curie temperature, ferromagnetic materials simply convert to or become or shows the behavior of paramagnetic materials. So these are the special case of paramagnetism limited to the range of temperature below the Curie point. And the examples of the ferromagnetic materials are nickel, cobalt, iron, etc. So, dear friends, in this session we have studied the three types of magnetic materials: diamagnetic, paramagnetic and ferromagnetic materials, and all the three can be classified and explained on the basis of net magnetic dipole moment associated with the atom in the material. In case of diamagnet, as we discussed, the net moment associated is zero. In paramagnetic material, the net magnetic dipole moment associated with an atom is positive, or say it has got some value but not that strong. And in case of ferromagnetic materials, a large number of magnetic dipole moments in a given area or region are strongly aligned in some particular direction, and these regions are known as domain. So on the basis of that, we can explain the di, para and ferromagnetic materials. And also we have seen that the susceptibility in case of diamagnetic material is negative, in case of paramagnetic material is positive, having smaller value but positive, but in case of ferromagnetic material it has got much higher value. So with all this, we stop here, and in the next session we will be discussing some other phenomenon associated with the current. Thank you.